If you haven't already, check out my gameplay channel, Zeltic Plays, where I'm in the middle of a hero mode playthrough of Link's Awakening. Breath of the Wild is, by far, the most ambitious game in the Zelda series. Taking place in the untamed wilds of a land scorched by the Great Calamity, an apocalypse which saw the kingdom's defenses turned on itself. The game packs in an incredible amount of concepts entirely new to the Zelda series, such as the ability to climb nearly any surface in the game, to explore the world freely without limits, and an intricate physics engine. But inevitably, when designing such a huge game, countless fascinating elements were left on the cutting room floor, like a huge variant of the common boar, apparently known as the Master Boar. But as we've seen time and time again, direct sequels to games often use unused ideas or assets from the original, like with Ocarina of Time and its sequel Majora's Mask. In an Iwata Asks interview, Aonuma explained that the central mechanic of Majora's Mask, the masks themselves, were included because they were an idea that wasn't fully utilized to its potential in Ocarina of Time, where masks and the Happy Mask salesman appear, but to a far lesser extent. So, what ideas were intended for Breath of the Wild, but didn't make it into the final game, that'd be cool to see in the sequel? Together with Commonwealth Realm, let's run through 5 unused ideas I'd love to see in Breath of the Wild 2. Hyrule Castle's Great Hall. Hyrule Castle is the closest thing Breath of the Wild has to a traditional dungeon, an intricate stronghold riddled with Ganon's influence, gatehouses trapping you in one-on-one battles with Lynels, countless corrupted guardian turrets, and towering pillars of malice. It's an incredibly fun part of the game. You've finally cleansed the 4 divine beasts of the poisonous blights and are now fighting through the heart of evil, ground zero of the calamity. That is, if you don't just skip the whole dungeon with Revali's Gale. Hyrule Castle includes a whole host of awesome areas. The Lockup, a menagerie of the game's toughest enemies, including a one-on-one test of bravery against a Stalnox. The Armory, a room where a moblin defends equipment used by royal guards, and Princess Zelda's room, where her diary sits among the rubble. But there's another interesting area which never made it into the main game, the Great Hall, featured here in Creating a Champion. In the book, we see concept art of the hall, which is a gigantic, opulent room featuring what could be a statue of a king, giant stone columns, and many banners emblazoned with the Hylian royal crest. But interestingly, the description for the artwork reads, "The Great Hall is not one of the areas of Hyrule Castle that Link can explore in the present. It was most likely located in a portion of the castle that was sealed off by the extensive damage caused by the Great Calamity." This description hints at an exciting possibility, that there's more to Hyrule Castle than we can see in-game, areas which are inaccessible due to damage or having been sealed off. The Great Hall is one of these areas, apparently cut off due to the Calamity. We know that, in the sequel, Ganondorf's awakening in the caves below Hyrule caused the castle to begin rising from the ground, similar to the shrines or the Sheikah Towers. If the castle rises from the ground, could it unearth areas of the citadel which were previously buried or otherwise sealed off? Could areas like the Great Hall, originally designed for Breath of the Wild, appear in the sequel? The Minish. The Minish Cap is my absolute favourite 2D game in the series. Its central mechanic is Link's ability to shrink to the size of the Minish, a race of tiny, mouse-like people who live in secret in Hyrule. The Minish are responsible for hiding rupees in grass and pots, as well as creating kinstones. The miniature people thrive off making Hylians happy. These people, also known as the Pecori, featured extensively in the Minish Cap and its story, and could be found all over Hyrule, inside holes in the walls, tree stumps, or roofs. But we haven't seen them since. If the Minish were still present in Hyrule in any other game, they pass by unnoticed, too tiny to see. but we learned during a look at the making of Breath of the Wild that the Minish, or a similar race, were planned for the game, even making it quite late into development, where the tiny folk were modelled for concept shots, living in small houses. Link is seen in this screenshot bending down to talk to one of them, and according to director Hidemaru Fujibayashi, these towns would have appeared all over the world, and Link himself could shrink down to explore them. However, the team found that, with all Breath of the Wild's other unique characters, it was hard to have the tiny people stand out in the game. They really wanted to include the race because of the gameplay possibilities, but regrettably had to give up on the idea. Seeing how much Fujibayashi wanted to include this race of tiny people in Breath of the Wild, I'd love to see the development team give their inclusion another go in the sequel. With more time to reflect and build on the original game's ideas, it'd be great to see a larger variety of races in the game. And who better than the Minish, living in small towns across the land, allowing Link to shrink down to interact with them. Link's family. Link's story in Breath of the Wild is a tragic one. While he eventually realizes his true destiny and defeats the Calamity, in the process he loses nearly everything close to him. He was born over 100 years before the game's events, and after being critically injured by a guardian during the Calamity, was sealed in the Shrine of Resurrection for a century. When he awakens, the world he knows is gone, its towns, peoples, families long dead. Outside of Link's relationships with the four champions, Daruk, Abosa, Mipha, and Revali, and his connection to Princess Zelda, Link's character isn't heavily explored in the game. We get glimpses into the depth of this incarnation of Link during the game, such as Zelda's diary, where we learn that he stays silent in order to help bear the weight of his task, and certain memories, like where Link trains in the rain, with Zelda taking shelter under a tree. While this memory is more a reflection of Zelda's character than Link's, we learn that he followed in his father's footsteps, who was a knight and a member of the Royal Guard. We never see Link's father in a memory, or indeed anywhere else in the game, but his impact on Link is an incredibly important part of the character of this hero. If Breath of the Wild 2 continues to explore Link's character and history, providing more insight into his life in Hyrule before the Calamity, the game could include an idea which was planned, but ultimately dropped, for the original, his family. In the Japanese version of Creating a Champion, known as Masterworks, there are pages of concept artwork collaged together in a sepia tone. We can see demo screenshots from the game, the famous Alien concept artwork which appeared during the making of video, but also this. Artwork of Link standing smiling next to a young girl holding a cuckoo, and a large, gruff, bearded man behind them, as well as artwork of a shrouded Link holding a spear, defending the same young girl. Notably, for whatever reason, this artwork was omitted from the Western release of the book, and a map of Hyrule takes its place, a map which already appears elsewhere in the book. But it seems clear that this artwork was intended to be Link's family, an idea which never made it into the final game. The young girl bears a resemblance to Aril, Link's younger sister in The Wind Waker, and the man bears a resemblance to Smith, Link's grandfather in the Minish Cap. Was it originally planned to include Link's family in Breath of the Wild, in a memory or otherwise? The emotional impact of Link's story, a hero out of his own time, exploring the wild, scorched corpse of his homeland, is already a dark tale. But including his family, who by the time Link awakens in the Shrine of Resurrection would be long dead, would have made the story even more heartbreaking. If Breath of the Wild 2 further explores the personality and history of this incarnation of the hero, perhaps it will bring forward this unused idea from the original, and include his family. A Mega Guardian. While I hope Breath of the Wild sequel strays from the oversaturated Sheikah themes from the original, including different enemy and dungeon designs, I'd be lying if I said I didn't want to see anything related to the mysterious Shadow Folk in the new game. The hyper-advanced tech of the Sheikah is one of the most fascinating things we've seen yet in the series, and it leads to the creation of some of the coolest designs we've ever seen, the behemoth divine beasts and terrifying mobile guardians. The latter are essentially Sheikah-built tanks, able to cover ground at surprising speed, and with a central cannon mounted in their hull, which can fire blasts of concentrated energy which obliterates anything in its path. After the Calamity Ganon resurfaced and seized control of the robotic army, these mechanical nightmares laid waste to the kingdom under his control, burning outposts, homes, and people with the cold, merciless efficiency of killing machines. But we learn an interesting tidbit about the Guardians in creating a champion, from a quote from the game's lead enemy artist, Takafumi Kayuchi, who states that in addition to the regular Guardians, they designed a giant, fortress-like Guardian equipped with multiple beam cannons. For whatever reason though, the team were unable to implement this Guardian variant, and it stayed on the drawing board. So, if Breath of the Wild 2 does include any Sheikah-built enemies, how about this planned colossal Guardian? Perhaps after the original tragic failure of the Army of Guardians, the machines were scrapped, so it could never happen again. But undiscovered, buried variants were activated and corrupted when Ganondorf awakened. While I felt that Breath of the Wild overused the Sheikah designs, they're some of the most interesting and uniquely terrifying opponents Link has ever faced. So I'd love to see this planned superior Guardian make an appearance in the sequel.
One of Breath of the Wild's defining mechanics is Link's ability to glide, an ability which, when paired with his ability to climb nearly on any surface, makes traversing the overworld really interesting. The paraglider is given to Link by the Old Man after his true identity as the spirit of King Rome is revealed. It's a small handheld kite designed with the emblem of the Rito on the material, suggesting that perhaps it was crafted by the race of Birdfolk in order to provide Hylians with the ability to fly without wings. Originally, during the game's development, we saw that the paraglider was intended to be the re-inclusion of the sailcloth, an important item from Skyward Sword, which we can see here in this Game Awards footage from late 2014. Despite looking like the sailcloth, the paraglider functions very similar to the Deculee from the Wind Waker, and this utility carried over to the main game. So, somewhere along the line, the decision to swap the sailcloth to the paraglider was made, and creating a champion gives us a look at what this design process may have looked like. We can see here concept artwork labeled New Glider. Whether this was an early design for the main paraglider or perhaps an intended upgrade for it is unclear. Either way, this glider has streamers which show Link the direction of the wind, which perhaps would have played a larger role in gliding like it did in the Wind Waker, along with a system for steering the glider. Seeing these designs for a more ambitious glider makes us wonder, might we see alternate glider designs in Breath of the Wild sequel? We know that the game will very likely feature the same climbing mechanics as the original, as it's set in the same Hyrule and featuring the same Link, so the ability to upgrade and swap gliders allowing for faster or more maneuverable air travel will be a really cool inclusion in the upcoming game.
So there you have my 5 picks for unused ideas Breath of the Wild sequel could include. A huge thanks to the Commonwealth Realm, who's compiled a list of his own picks.
And that was 5 examples of cut content from Breath of the Wild that might resurface in Breath of the Wild 2. We did another 5 on my channel, Commonwealth Realm, so make sure after this video to hop over and check it out.
If you like this video, leave a like or subscribe if you haven't already for more Zelda content. Cheers guys, and I'll see you next time.